growing up in Oakland, it was a tough part, because it was a lot of warfare going on. You know, crack cocaine came in. So you've seen a lot of people dying. And it was either, you know, get away or be a part of what was happening in the environment. I think after I got to junior high, everything was just like just spinning out of control. And that's where I got lost at. Just got lost, you know, lost in the system. And then you didn't really have anybody to, you know, kind of pull you up and, you know, give you advice. And, you know, I didn't read. I just hated reading. My mind wanders. You know, I'm not good in testing. I mean, I was always fighting in school, always fighting, always getting sent out. So you kind of get away from what you're there for, because I was always told by educators that I wouldn't mount up to anything, that I wouldn't be anything. I used to pray, you know, I didn't think I was going to make past 21, you know, especially as being African-American. You know, it's a lot of things that's against you. You know, I didn't think I was going to make it, and I knew I had to make a change. My godparents gave me that opportunity, and I moved out of Oakland and got away from the environment. I had somebody that was in my corner that believed in me. I found out I had a learning disability in my late 20s. I was in Job Corps, and I noticed when I was getting the one-on-one lessons with the teachers and stuff, I was learning more. My parents, godparents at the time, but well, parents, worked with me so that when I had the foundation, it was okay to say, hey, you know, you learn differently. Oh, okay. Yeah, you're right. You know, after dropping out of high school, not really having that self-esteem, I feel I couldn't do anything, but I was around the right people that gave me encouragement every day. What made me think I can be a teacher is once that foundation was really solid, I figured I can do anything. Going to college was totally different from high school, and it was really up to you to do what you had to do. And I noticed just by being in college, it made a lot of things easier for me, because I stayed behind and talked to that professor, or I called the professor, or shot an email to the professor, like, I'll be at your door at 10:30 in the morning. I just need some help and some ideas. And I think a lot of instructors and professors buy into that, like, okay, this student is not trying to BS me. This student is really out to get some help. I remember taking a test. It was a multiple choice test. Did a lot of erasing. And I turned in my test to the teacher. The teacher accused me of cheating. And I was like, no, I didn't cheat. You erased too much. And so I had to go down and find a counselor. Remember me when I was there to kind of vouch for me. Talking to the professor and letting them know the disability, then I was able to pass the class with an A. But, you know, I prefer, like, presenting. If I can present, no problem. Something that I worked on. But just sitting down, taking a test, I'm really struggling with that, even today. I took a course, and it was mainly like a lecture course, and I just couldn't get it down. I just couldn't do it. So I went to the professor at the, I think, the first couple of classes, and asked to do some extra credit, and the professor turned me down. He was like, no, we're not doing any extra credit. You can't do any other projects. So I ended up failing the class. When I took a college class in math, it was on video. And that was like the best thing for me, because even though it had 13 videotapes of Algebra 1, I was able to pause it, I was able to stretch, I was able to go back to it, I was able to rewind it, I was still able to move around and get it. It was really good to know my professors. I mean, I was stay after work, after class, every day, and just helping that professor come up with solutions. Like, man, I will do this, I will do that, not trying to get an easy ride, but just letting them know, this is the way I learn. I think I had one teacher, I enjoyed going to his class, just because he taught in a way, I think he was teaching for everybody. It wasn't a lot of lecture class, like, you know, he gave you assignment, and he made sure he had that one-on-one. It starts with education. That's like pretty much the bottom line. So I figured getting into teaching will help a lot of kids, a lot of students.
If the teachers, instructors, or professors can teach the generation that's coming in about teaching, just to teach not one way, but many ways.
Education can make a huge impact in gang violence. Keeping the kids in school, because a lot of these kids get recruited when they're not in school. Breaking that cycle once these kids are in our school and just trying to meet the needs. If a teacher would have gave me that chance, I would have graduated from high school. So if we can adapt our way we teach and have open ears and an open heart, you know, kids are going to do good. And I think, too, we label. We get a label on somebody and we don't let it go. Student can't read, student can't write, student drop out.
Go back to the hood.
Go back to the hood. You know, go to jail. I wanted to be a guy that said, look, I'm from here. This is what I went through. I made it out. Now I'm coming back.
Tiago received his master's degree and currently works with high school students like himself. Tiago's suggestions? Provide alternative ways to demonstrate mastery of the subject. Use other teaching modalities to reach those who don't learn from lectures. Provide course materials electronically so they can be converted into multiple formats, for example, audio or large print. Take advantage of the student's background and capabilities. Create the sense that students are receiving some one-on-one instruction. Don't allow students to stereotype each other.